Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kati Marton, and it's a genuine privilege to welcome you to the Council's freshly launched series on global women leaders. And who better to start this series of meetings than the great Sadako Ogata, who most of you in this room know well and are familiar with her astonishing career. But before we go to Madame Ogata, I would just like to acknowledge the sponsor and the initiator of this series, which is the Merck Corporation. And Ken Frazier, under your leadership, Merck is playing an active role in promoting women's health and empowerment and leadership worldwide. And this series is just another illustration of that commitment to women. So we thank you, and we look forward to this series unfolding. It's absolutely fitting that Mrs. Ogata is here with us today, because in fact, it has been 40 years since Mrs. Ogata arrived to our town as a public delegate to the United Nations in 1968. And that was only the beginning of her astonishing career. But before we make another move, can I encourage you that this would be the time to make sure that anything that beeps, squeaks, things, burps in your bag and briefcase is now silenced. And this meeting is on the record. So, Mrs. Ogata, I've admired you from near and far. You have been present in some of the most dangerous and important events of the last 40 years. And I remember when I landed in the Balkans in the mid-90s on a mission for the Committee to Protect Journalists, and I was told about this amazing new head of the new United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, who had been issued the UN's smallest flak jacket, which I was told hit you in the ankles, but of course there was nothing modest in the size of what you achieved in your 9 years as UN High Commissioner.
10 years.
Excuse me. Even more amazing, 10 years as High Commissioner for Refugees. But before that, in the 70s, you were your nation's troubleshooter in Myanmar, Burma, but I believe you started as a modest academic. And in the 60s, and somehow along the way you managed to raise two children, and I think we need to credit your wonderful husband for the support he's given you. He's also a distinguished economist, and the two of you have served both your own country of Japan and the world with equal dedication. So for that we thank you. Our topic tonight is the changing face of human security, and Sadako, you have put the human into international security. And let me just ask you to say a few words, if you would, about the lessons that you've learned in the field in this spectacular run that you've had and are still having. Everybody has your bio, so I didn't want to belabor the point and list all the many decorations that you've won. I think you're the world's most decorated human being, or among them, or to list off all the posts that you've held. Suffice to say that there isn't a trouble spot that you haven't visited, and there isn't a region that you haven't made somewhat better, particularly in the field of human security and those most vulnerable, that is to say, women, children, the elderly, who are the victims of the current spate of global conflict. So, Mrs. Ogata, can you share with us a few of the lessons that you've learned in your work in the field?
Well, thank you very much for your really very generous introduction. I don't know what is in my bio, but it seems to be rather on the long side. But I am very pleased that I have been guest or of the council or participating in various research projects over the years. But this is the first time that I've been asked to inaugurate a series of lecture series on a global women's leadership role. And I'd like to congratulate the council, but also for the sponsor, the Merck, for starting this. Women means a great deal. I mean, it's half humanity to start with. And why you have to start a series now, I don't know. It's maybe because the council started more like a men's club.
Well,
maybe. I'm just saying maybe.
If we look around the wall.
Yes, exactly.
One would be led to believe that.
But these are very fine gentlemen. I really have a lot of admiration. But since I would really Katie mentioned that it's 40 years ago that I came. It was 1968 for the General Assembly that I came to the United Nations for the first time. Of course, I studied about the United Nations a great deal and so on. I studied political science, I studied international affairs, I studied history, particularly Japan, Asia, U.S. relations, that kind of history. And since I'm only given 5 minutes to really sum up, I thought I would just give a few contrasting thoughts and positions. I started as from World of Ideas. That is what I mean by scholarships. World of Ideas and moved into more the world of action. I think that's one transformation that I think I went through. And then another one is again on security issues, from state security to incorporating human security. That's another transformation that I think I went through, not only intellectually, but in terms of action. And then the third transformation may be from humanitarian work to development work. And that's where I'm landed right now. In the future, what kind of changes I will go through, I don't know. But it's not because of me, because the world is really a very, very rapidly changing, moving world that we're living in. And the real issue, I think, is how can you really work through the 21st century with practices, habits, assumptions of the 20th century? This is a very big one that I think we all have to think about. I'm not giving answers yet. But I think it was I had the privilege of really studying a lot of international affairs even when I was in high school and college in Japan. But to move into the world of scholarship, which is a wonderful world, and I would rather keep on going to something that you do something about your knowledge. And this is started when I first came to the United Nations as a public delegate, 68, and then 70, 75, I kept on coming here. And what did I learn? That the world consists of lots of countries, big and small, lots of people and delegates, brilliant and clever, but nothing. I mean, there's all kinds of combination of people in the world. And I think I learned that fact by being really in the General Assembly and the various committees a great deal. You know, it was a big shock to me when a small country, a delegate from a small country in Africa, I don't think I should name it, could be so influential in committee matters. It does make a difference if you have articulate thinking and, what shall I say, beyond your national capacity kind of delegate. It does affect, and this was something that I learned. Big countries, big influential countries don't necessarily have the same kind of influence in public forums. And I've kept on realizing this. And I think this is something that when you deal with people, you have to deal with people with what they all have. That was one thing. Now, from where did I move from security? Because from 1991 through 2000, for 10 years, I was the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees, And in that capacity, I was invited here at the Council to give various reports and ask for much more support in the sense of policy support. Why did I think about humans? See, originally, the United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees is really to deal with refugees, which means people who cross national borders. And no, because of persecution, because of threat, because of different religious beliefs and so on, they are no longer under the protection of their state and have to cross borders to seek protection from others. I mean, even passports are very simple proof. You no longer have the support of your country. The country would not give you passports. So in this sense, the responsibility to protect them and assist them falls on the High Commissioner for Refugees, the office. And these were very difficult times that I dealt with, because many of the conflicts were not only in between states, but inside the states. When the states no longer protected their people, that's when internal conflict starts. And this was the time when there was the Balkan conflict, there was the Great Lakes region in Africa, there was the disintegration of federal states, the Soviet Union. These were very big times when people within their own states had to flee, or had to at least not only flee, hide. It was a very difficult time. And so we began thinking, not only me, but in the office thinking, what is really protection? Should we just rely on the state forever for protection, or is there other way of looking at it? And we started talking about human security. We should much more focus on the people, their security. Their security sometimes means physical security, but to be sure that they can know that they can live the next day. I mean, when you sometimes, if you're in extreme poverty, you don't know whether you can go to a hospital, you don't know even whether you will have food the next day. That is insecurity too. So this all people-led, people-focused concept of security came out in the course of the 1990s from development assistance people, but also from a lot of security-related thinking as well.
But may I just at that point ask you, the United Nations was created really to deal with wars between among nations.
Yes.
And yet the most dangerous situations on the globe now are intra-state related. And it is let me ask you this, at what point does a state forfeit its right to sovereignty? And at what point does the world community, i.e. the United Nations, have the right to interfere in that nation's sovereignty? Can you explain that?
Because I think that's all right. When you have conflicts within states, I think maybe the Balkans are a good example. That federal state was dissolving into various states within. International state borders that existed within the federal state was going to turn into international borders, because each one aspired to be independent. And in this case, I think it was very fortunate that the Status of Refugees Convention was clear enough on protecting people crossing national borders, that we knew exactly who to protect and who not to protect. But when this whole system, the basic assumptions of the state existence of protecting people were dissolving, there was nobody else but the High Commissioner for Refugees to intervene, and also the ICRC. UN doesn't have to, this General Assembly doesn't have to tell me that. I can do that, because the convention is strong enough and clear enough. However, there were dilemmas.
But the UN now is empowered to intervene, I should say, on behalf of human security situations. But is it using that new power? We're watching an unfolding potential genocide or already genocide in a number of places, starting with Sudan, Darfur. And yet, I don't see the UN using that power.
Well, if you try to think, the UN was established in 1945 as an interstate organization.
Right.
Exactly. At the same time, when I just use the example of conflicts, internal conflicts, mm-hmm. but when the world is turning much more globalized mm-hmm. in terms of information, flow of money, flow of information, flow of people, yeah. the basis of an interstate organization is under crisis in a way.
Yes.
But when it gets the question of protecting people, we had some dilemmas. I mean, are these people crossing borders so that I can, from my mandate, easily address it? Or just because the same people fled the country, we went through this in Somalia, coming into Kenya and all that, some people who crossed the border and went into Kenya was clearly under the mandate that the High Commissioner was given from the General Assembly. We don't go around asking each case, should we do this? We have to act. But what do you do with people who didn't quite cross the border, but were fleeing for the same reason? You know what we did? Cross-border operation. We reached into it because the real idea is helping people.
Yes.
But there are dilemmas. No. If you go to the General Assembly all the time, maybe they'll say interference and all this. But the Security Council, which was assigned to maintain international peace and security, had a hard time over the Balkans. And I think I was the first High Commissioner ever to be asked to go to the Security Council. There was the wonderful Cyrus Vance and people like that who wanted me to come along with them. What do you do? Do you let people die just because you cannot cross the one border, or do you go in? And I think I brought the issue of the importance of focusing on people crossing borders, not crossing borders, but from the same cause to be able to protect them.
What do you see today as the most explosive situation or potentially explosive situation that isn't getting the attention of either the UN or the public?
Well, Darfur, as you said, is one of them.
Mm-hmm.
I think internally, well, Iraq, there's a lot of refugees coming out, but there are lots of people who are not able to go out. There are these situations, yes.
And do you see the international community as do you see, is the trend positive as far as you can discern toward less respect for the sacred right of sovereignty and more for vulnerable populations?
Yeah, the sacred right for sovereignty, if you don't exercise your sovereignty responsibly, I think there are questions. I think there are questions raised. And this is because in a world where you know, you have information, you know what is happening.
Yes. I think we're riveted right now with the terrible scenes of what's going on in Tibet, and where the Chinese are exercising their sacred right of sovereignty, and they're very reluctant to have anyone else offer any assistance or help. What would you advise would be the right policy toward Chinese?
I don't think it's very good to politicize these things too much, but try to make sure to talk with the Chinese authority, extend whatever assistance you can do. Remember Chechnya. In Chechnya, it was the Soviet Union, the Social Affairs Ministry, or whether it was just called the Commission, I can't remember, who asked UNHCR to help.
Mm-hmm.
In the Balkans, when in Croatia, there were people who were displaced, couldn't go back to their country and all that. It was Yugoslavia, right?
Yes.
Came and asked us, if you're dealing with these things in a purely humanitarian aspect, there are governments. No government is comfortable having their people in extremely difficult and dangerous situation. But if you go around politicizing and criticizing, then they would not come. So I think humanitarian work has to be carried out in a discreet way. No, at the same time, there's a dilemma, because humanitarian work cannot solve the underlying problems, which are usually political. So what would you advise?
I don't want you to make a politically compromising declaration, but what would be the correct approach?
If you are dealing in humanitarian affairs,
say in Tibet or Darfur, for that matter, another country that has
Darfur has a very complicated background of. I think even environmental degradation,
yes.
A lot of different people in different places. And I think there is within the country, it's a huge country, neighboring country. It's a very, very complicated situation, which I think I was very happy to see the African Union trying to
yes.
deal with it. And this did not quite succeed. And this is why the Sudan government kept on insisting that there should be no outside interference in peacekeeping and so on. I think more assistance given to African Union in their very basic security activity needs would have helped more. But now they have become made a hybrid between African Union and the United Nations. If I was just told that if there were 24 helicopters given to this hybrid peacekeeping operation by the international community, a lot of the security question can be managed. I don't know. But those who are criticizing are not necessarily giving always the most necessary assistance. That I can say.
Well, you're legendary for your diplomatic skills,
and we're seeing
an example of that here. And Mrs. Ogata, you've just been to the Middle East a few days ago. What is another place where the humanitarian security issue continues to, if anything, be degraded on both sides? Can you give us a field report from your observations there?
I cannot really do that. Uh-huh. I mean, there are many experts on the Middle East here present.
None of them with your particular background.
Well, my angle is really trying to help the most affected people, the refugees and the displaced, and then the vulnerable people. So from that point of view,
yes.
I think sovereignty issue has to be treated in a more mellowed way, yes. But the difficulty is really, especially when it gets to the Middle East, Israel and Palestinian issue, it's a very complex one. It has questions to do with borders, has something to do with settlements, has something to do with refugees, all sorts of things that have to be dealt with in a comprehensive way. And I think this is being done without really coming to an agreed point. And in the meantime, a development agency like JICA, which is trying to do something through development work that would bring a little bit better conditions altogether. I didn't talk really about development work, but development has work. You know, it's easy to develop a poor country with no political problems, no security problems, no racial, that's fine. But when it
is there such a country?
I don't know. But let me be honest, I think development agencies tend to believe that that's the situation.
Yeah. You know, you're such a positive person and such a role model for me and thousands of women around the globe. Do you ever get discouraged?
Oh, yes.
Certainly. What discourages right. you? What are the things that...
Well, when you really cannot reach out to the people who are in the greatest need, that is very discouraging. But one of my, maybe David remembers some of the people, David Hamburg, one of the advisors we had informally from the real world, political leaders and so on, said, why do you have to deal so much with bastards, he said.
Bastards
is a word, because I was dealing with all the bad people. You have to deal with what he called bastards if you want to do good for the people who are
Is that a diplomatic term, bastard?
That was a business person who. But, you know, I had to always deal with the difficult governments and difficult leaders, the good people. I don't have to.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but you've had a notable record of success with these bastards. I'm just quoting. Last week, the French Foreign Minister, Bernard Kouchner, who is a great friend of America, was quoted as saying that America will never recapture its global stature. Quite a sweeping statement. How do you react to that?
He likes to make sweeping statements. But he's a very action-oriented person.
He's action-oriented and he loves America.
I didn't know.
Yeah. For a Frenchman, he loves America. We're obviously caught up in an election year here. We're not going to draw you into that. But do you agree that, first of all, do you think that it's important for the United States to be the global leader or a global leader?
Well, it's inevitably the global leader. And this is why how you lead is relevant to everybody else. But we don't have votes for that, so.
Yes. And and how would you react to Kushner's statement that?
I don't know. I really didn't know what he said.
Well, he just said that it was a sweeping statement that the United States has lost so much stature.
I see. Mm.
That we have lost a great deal of our ability to lead at a time when the world is looking for leadership.
Maybe he meant some of the. Human rights abuses that came out in the Abu Ghraib and all these things.
Guantanamo.
Mm-hmm. Those are things that I think, because you stand for these principles and then you didn't act according to the principles. And this was something that I think was very disappointing to all of us who have looked for to the United States.
But irreversibly disappointing?
No, we'll still look to the future. I mean, we're looking very much to see how you're going to evolve your leadership.
Mm-hmm. No? Let's talk for a moment, since you are here as a global women's leader. Let's talk for a moment about the special needs of women in war situations, in extreme situations of unfolding crisis. They do have special needs, and I'm speaking of displaced persons, internally displaced persons, and refugees. Is the United Nations, in your opinion, stepping up to those needs? Is there a greater awareness?
Oh, there is a greater awareness of protecting and women mm-hmm. in these warlike situations. And also trying to empower them. There is a great deal of attempt, but to put what the United Nations is advocating into practice in every part of the world is a slightly different question. But I can, there are two situations. UNHCR, together with the people in the local people, initiated what is called Women's Initiative in two places. One was in the Balkans, and the other one was in Rwanda. And that is in immediate post-conflict situations. First of all, there are many more women than men, because many men were fighting and then were lost. So women were left, women and girls, really, family heads of family of 14 year old with three or five sisters and brothers. That was the situation you found in the Balkans. And we tried to focus on women as the mainstay for post-conflict reconstruction. And we would organize women groups we would first of all make sure that the women's legal rights to inheritance and all these things were intact. And we would strengthen the legal basis, but also organize many training centers and opportunities for making sure that women would be at the center of the reconstruction. And after we did that in the Balkans, then came the Rwanda genocide and all that followed. And we adopted that same women initiative to Rwanda. And you know, this is one country today that has more than 50% women representation in the parliament. And I was just told the other day by one of the young women leaders at that time that it's owed a lot to this women initiative. And we would make sure that they had the legal rights, but also help them individually almost. And also we made a women's center where they could come, share their woes, but also be trained in a way that they could make a living. And I am very pleased that I am advocating to all those groups that are doing post-conflict reconstruction to put women into that mainstay, because they can prove a lot. So these are realities.
Another new problem that the United Nations faces is protecting the protectors. That is to say, that the UN is no longer immune from attack itself. Of course, the most dramatic instance was Sergio Piero de Mello and his team in Baghdad attacked. But we've had other instances worldwide recently in Algeria.
Yes.
How does the UN and the UN, in my opinion, does its most important work in the field? How do you protect field workers, the people who worked for you, Mrs. Ogata? How do you keep them in the field and yet safe from attack?
Well, it depends on how you interpret the importance of your mission in the field. I have had very terrible situations, and we lost colleagues, whether it was in West in Africa or everywhere. I mean, in Indonesia, in Timor, West Timor.
East Timor.
Yes, West Timor, when among the refugees who had a lot of resentment against the West, Indonesia, and so on. The refugee group was very difficult to protect, and my colleagues were attacked. It was really on the General Assembly, first day of the Millennium General Assembly, that I heard the question of three of my colleagues being massacred. And these things happen, and also UN should give all the precautions over training staff to know how to behave, putting security officers and so on. At the same time, if you're going to be kept within the safest compounds, why would you be entrusted with the world, with these work? So I think it's a big dilemma, but a challenge, that you try to make security coverage 100%, but you know that it will never be 100%. And then you have to weigh it against the importance of the mission you're carrying out. I had long discussions with Kofi Annan and over these things, because we went through this.
Yeah.
Then it's the responsibility of the person in charge. How much, how far and thoroughly you have covered, but how important it is, the function itself.
Well, shall we open the questioning
to... Sure, yes, difficult questions already.
I did my best. Yes, Evelyn.
Hi, Evelyn Leopold. In the years I covered you as a journalist at the UN in the Security Council, there was this guy who was the U.S. ambassador. You may know him, Kati. It was Richard Holbrooke.
No, I didn't.
Who said that the distinction between IDPs, internally displaced people, and refugees should be eliminated. And you fought it and said you certainly didn't have the resources. And the Balkans was a big exception. Do you see that line eroding, or does that premise that you stated then still hold true?
I remember Mr. Holbrooke's statement. I concurred 100% with what he was saying. But where, at the same time, you know, UNHCR couldn't cover all the refugees and all the displaced persons for resource reasons. But not only that, there had to be some sharing of particular responsibilities. And what at that time we examined and concluded that if there are same people fleeing for the same reason, some crossing the border, some not quite crossing the border, and then both cases UNHCR should extend. I mean, we did cross-border operations. We would go in and try to help people who couldn't make quite the last 1,000 meters or something like that. So that's the way, but I don't know how it is now, because there are many other agencies that are now coming in for doing a lot for the internally displaced. But I remember these early discussions, and I was very appreciative of what Mr. Holbrook said. He understood.
Right. Yes, could you identify yourself, please, before you ask your question?
Thank you. Maura McLean with the Africa America Institute. And I first want to say, Mrs. Ogata, that Japan should appoint someone of your caliber to their development aid agency as an indication of the importance that they place on it. And I wish...
I didn't know why they put me into it.
Well, I wish that our own country would follow suit. And who knows, hope springs eternal. But in any case, what would you... Particularly in light of your transitions from ideas to action, and I imagine you're combining those, and reflecting on the transition from state to human security, what would be is the most profound external intervention or contribution from a development standpoint to the African continent?
To the African situation in particular? Well, I think it is maybe more focused in Africa because there is a lot of these cases. There are two points. You see, development assistance tended to be very much sectoral. Some people just do education. A lot just on health, agriculture, water. And then the human security concept was most looking at the benefit of the people. People don't have the health sector and the whatever is dissected like that. So if you look at the whole human being, you have to look at the community base. And I think the human security concept in a development area would try to bring in the whole community security up front and try to cross sectors. And this is something I'm purposely doing with in my office, JICA, but also it is also being understood and spreading. That's one thing. And then the other thing is development work usually goes through recipient governments. But in most situations, especially if it's conflict-ridden, governments are very weak. You cannot wait till governments become strong in order to extend development assistance. So we have... The human security approach allows, or at least we're using it, to move in much more quickly and trying to link up with the humanitarian work that is coming up. Those are, I think, two trends that I see, and we are practicing them as the human security concept spreads.
Thank you. Yes.
At Rosenfield Carnegie Corporation, this question follows on Moore's. Perhaps you could elaborate then a little bit more on what you said at the beginning of your speech, that how the world in the 21st century, how the world is going to get through the 21st century with practices and habits of the 20th century. And it would be wonderful if you would elaborate that on that a little bit more, Mrs. O'Connor.
Good question.
Well, this I pose as more of a question, because look at the United Nations. Now, United Nations has dozens of operational agencies. It's very different from 1945, when delegates assembled and decided everything. Now, that is no longer the real situation of a globalizing world. And so UN is catching up in the sense that they're doing it through various agencies. I don't know how many there are anymore. But at the same time, when it gets to the the Security Council or to the General Assembly. It's usually the state delegates which would decide on situations that require much more sort of co-responsible sovereignty kind of thing. Now, how you put that into an organization or institutional setup, I don't know. But there are people who are thinking about those things now.
That's me. I am so embarrassed. Oh my God. Forgive me. And you know what? It's your friend Holbrook.
Oh, I see.
calling from Peshawar.
Well,
that's his only
well.
Defense. Where it's morning. I apologize. That's terrible. Robin, you get the next question.
This is Ogata, since I'm such a long-time admirer of yours and it works in the U.N., I'm going to give you a question about the dilemma of the United States today. We have in Jordan about 800,000 refugees from Iraq. We have over 1 million in Syria.
That's right, yes.
Most of these are the educated class, in effect, the most substantial people in the country who have fled. What can we do to relocate them? They don't want to go back to Iraq at this point. There is no order. There's nothing there for them. But at the same time, they can't get a job. They're running through their money. And those of us who are working in that area with them are looking for possibilities where to help them to relocate. This is a catastrophic problem because they really can't go home.
And the United States has not done its share.
And we have not taken, of course.
You have taken some, though, haven't you?
We have taken some, but considering...
Not enough.
I think the majority of those who are in Jordan and Syria will stay there until they can go back. And these countries are under enormous strain. Mm. And I think we should... Those who cannot do much more direct work should help them. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was in Syria just last week. There were about 1.5 million. Mm-hmm. And the strain is really on the basic humanitarian development areas like hospitals, schools, and so on.
And these are refugees who are not living in camps.
No,
they're living,
all over
because
the place.
They're not officially declared refugees. They're living with people.
Well, the camp situation doesn't really exist in these places. They're in houses.
Which makes it more difficult to
But I think even on humanitarian grounds, let's hope that they can go back and they would like to go back.
Yeah.
And so maybe United States is a big country and a very important one. So perhaps you could help through the United States too.
Yes. Identify yourself.
Thank you. Janet Benchoff, Global Justice Center. I appreciate your remarks about the 21st century, and I want to congratulate Japan for becoming the latest member to accede to the Rome Treaty of the ICC.
Finally.
But now I want to ask you a question about turning an accession into action. I think one change we've seen is an evolution in international human rights and humanitarian law. And why don't we see an action calling for the Myanmar-Burma junta to have to account for their war crimes when they have no criminal justice system? You were working with them in 1990, and what has happened since then are gang rapes, genocide, more crimes against humanity. They have flouted the United Nations 28 times, and therefore are undermining the rule of law that you have worked so hard for. So why aren't we talking about criminal accountability and the Security Council referring them to the International Criminal Court? Thank you.
No, I am maybe an impatient person because there were many potential criminals, whether it was out of Rwanda or out of Bosnia, very all over, Serbia, everywhere.
Sierra Leone.
And the law is, and I only wish that the law could be implemented much more quickly. Because I knew that in my time, these people we had who were of a very dubious character cannot be really. Some were caught in a long lingering ad hoc courts, whether for Rwanda or for Serbia. You know, I realized I could not rely on them to settle the kind of in-between problems we had. Now, I'm not a lawyer, so I cannot say, I'm not in criticizing, but the law practice and the procedures are not quite up to what we need on the ground. And if you can have a way of finding some good temporary arrangements that way. Because what UNHCR always did was really plead for amnesty. That was the clause we really wanted to be brought in when this post-conflict situations arose. And it's not an easy one. But without amnesty clause introduced, the return was always very difficult.
But the International Criminal Court is such a valuable tool for the UN.
It is important.
And again, I have the feeling that it's a tool like the right to intervene inside sovereign states. It's not a tool that's being sufficiently used.
Well, the modalities of using the tool is a very important. Right to intervene, fine. In what way are you going to intervene? And then it becomes very complicated.
Yes, there are no simple issues. Yes, sir, you had your...
Leonid Kishkovsky, World Conference of Religions for Peace. As the World Conference of Religions for Peace reflected on your achievement, Madame Ogata, in helping the international community move from concepts of national security, international security, to human security, we began to reflect what would this imply for religious communities around the world. And at our 8th World Assembly in Kyoto in 2006, we began in our World Alliance of Religious Communities to speak about shared security as something that could enable religious communities to make some constructive contribution to the process you began by beginning to speak of human security. Now, given that the world's population of what, some 7 billion, has in it approximately 5 to 6 billion people who identify themselves as belonging to religious communities, what would you think would be an appropriate contribution of religious communities globally and regionally and nationally towards relief, development, and especially the building of human security globally?
Thank you. Well, that's a big one.
That's
for
a
you.
Very big one. Religion always, religious communities really, in principle, go for love, benevolence, understanding, etc. The world needs more of that. At the same time, the world requires justice to be put into place. So between justice and tolerance, or it's a very, very tall order to say, this, I stand for this, or I stand for that. I think it depends a lot of enlightened and generous leaders to weigh through these things. I don't think there's one answer that justice is more supreme than love, or the other way around. It depends on the degree degree of tolerating injustice. That is another thing that is very real in the world. And with time, sometimes people forget. It's not a bad thing, I think, that you sometimes forget and try to look to the future. But it depends really on persons. I have come across many people as I was going around. I think the two biggest experiences I had was really in the Balkans and also a lot in Africa, in the Great Lakes region. Sometimes it needs people to forget, too. Mm-hmm. Also, of course, you have to have justice. You have to have also of reconciliation measures, and at the end, maybe forget.
Can you give an example of a place that's been successful in forgetting and moving on, as opposed to a place
that... I don't think this is a question of forgetting in the case of Rwanda. I mean, the Rwandan genocide was a real one, and very, very serious. We had to deal with a lot of the genocidaires who fled to Congo. Dealing with them was a very serious issue. And then at the end, many of them were sort of forced back. And then after that, how much could they coexist? And this is when the Women's Initiative was important. We would run reconciliation seminars. I mean, these were people who did it, and we were trying to help that. And somehow, a lot of them are living together now.
Yes.
There were some, maybe 200,000 people in jail. It was a long time they were in jail, to waiting justice. It took a long time. The Rwandese introduced a traditional court system called the Gacaca. I've gone and seen them, trying to have the village leaders listen to the pleas of these people and pass judgment. To the extent it was a minor case, they would give them community volunteer work or something like that. Serious ones, they would take it to the formal courts. I was told that through there were some 30,000 left in jails, very, very serious ones. Towards the end of this year, they would probably try to solve all of it. Mm. And this is a very important step towards reconciliation.
You had your hand up.
Madam Ogata, my name is Elizabeth Cobbs with Mark. I'm just delighted to be here tonight and to listen and learn from your experiences, not only as a female leader, but as a Japanese female leader. And I'm very interested to understand, I know that human security is a key issue for the Japanese government, and they've been pushing in this direction. And as hosts of the G8 this year, human security is one of the key themes. I would like to hear from you more about JICA's role and what you see might come out of the G8 this year.
Well, you see, human security concept came from several different sources, but one of them was in 1978, when the then Prime Minister Obuchi was really, no, Asia was moving rather well on economic development. And then with the financial crisis of 78, a lot of people in Southeast Asia were really left with no sources, no security for the future and all that. It was a devastating situation. And Japan being about to be a non-military power, the Prime Minister and some of the people there, I would say was quite far-sighted in the sense that they really wanted to opt for human security establishment, which really meant more social context brought in. And this is how Japan's input into human security went in, while others from other continents or for various humanitarian agencies, including UNHCR and so on, were talking about humanitarian human security from a conflict point of view. And that sort of merged together. And I think there's a general acceptance of the concept of human security in Japanese governmental and NGO sources. How much we practice that is something that you have to watch, and I have to watch too.
Yes, sir. This gentleman here.
Hi, I'm from Minister of Finance in Japan. Sorry to say the comment. I have the quite impression towards the human security activities, but honestly speaking, the fund is from the Japanese government is accumulated only 300 million. So I personally don't think it's enough to raise. The size is not enough. But compared to this size, you know, since last year, the so-called supply issues is getting down. The global loss of over the $5 billion the 1 year. So compared with this loss, the 300 million is very tiny. So, Mr. Ogata, do you have any plans to activate the money from worldwide? Because today there's a lot of the business person is participate in this meeting. So, but in how the not only government but also the private sectors can be contributed to this initiative on the worldwide. This humanitarian activity is making improved. So, do you have any ideas?
Thank you. Can you?
Human security is not a money eating kind of a concept. So, you can, within various budgetary confines, you can practice these. But I would really think, I'm very glad that you come from the Minister of Finance, because the Japanese ODA proportion within the budget is about 1.6 or 7%. I think that's too small. Thank you.
We have time for two more. David, would you like to? And then this gentleman.
David Hamburg, Cornell Medical Center. First of all, let me express my eternal gratitude to you for the opportunity of working with you during your years as High Commissioner. It's beyond expression what it was like to observe you in action. During those years and since, in your book a few years ago, which has not been mentioned so far, you raised the question repeatedly, where are the political leaders who allow this to happen, looking into a camp, let's say, like Goma? Or, even more, where are the political leaders who cause this to happen? Where is the discourse in the world that could clarify and change over time, the attitudes and insights and abilities of world leaders to prevent this from happening? Your book is very strong on that. Now, you yourself, from my observation, had a strong impact on Kofi Annan, and it's carried over to Ban Ki-moon, as I see it. The Secretary General has some capacity to stimulate the General Assembly and the Security Council, where world leaders can consider how they are generating so many refugees and internally displaced persons. But that's a limited capacity, I have to say. And I wonder what you think about the foci of discussion of serious possibilities for changing norms and practices among world leaders with respect to preventing the impacts that generate so many dreadful refugee situations. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think, David, you have been a really very strong advocate of prevention and so on, and we have followed your sign and your initiatives very much. If there's a little interesting insight to what the African Union has said recently, I hope I have the... It says, non-intervention in internal affairs, they are from there to saying, not tolerating indifference. That's a very wise statement. I just picked it up the other day. Don't tolerate indifference.
Yeah.
From not interfering in internal affairs, which was a very strong principle of the African Union for a long time. Now there is some talk about don't tolerate indifference. And I think that is a very, very important step that is coming out of a continent.
And much more palatable for many players.
Yes, but it's not an easy one, mm-hmm. if you really put it together. So
yes,
maybe that's a good sign.
This gentleman, and then I think we have to close the meeting. Yes, sir.
My name is Chandrakant Pancholi from Overseas India Weekly. Can you please tell us your experiences in Afghanistan and how the Timor and the Middle Eastern culture affects your work, and how is the situation in Japan about Koreans? Can they acquire citizenship anytime?
I should be daring enough to say, please read my book. I did have a chance to launch it here, and that's a lot of Afghanistan and so on. And Koreans, I think there is a, when Japan became party to the Refugee Convention, there were also a lot of opening of the Korean nationality issue within Japan. And they are, many of them are taking Japanese nationality. So in this sense, the human, the Refugee Convention to become party meant also the need to deal with minority people within your own countries. And I think there was some improvement there. But Japan is not very much of a refugee receiving country or asylum. We're not as generous to asylum as I think we should be. And there's a very strong feeling among some people. And there's some trend of becoming more open to asylum now. And I hope this will. Also, again, in this very interdependent world, this is a very important thing.
Well, Mrs. Ogata, with that, I think I speak for all of us here when I say that we have all benefited tremendously from your example, from your life story, from your spirit, and your amazing body of work and achievements, and you're still achieving yet more things for on behalf of a grateful
thank
world.
Thank you very
so
much.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.